What is going on, everybody? We are back with another episode of the IOST Podcast. Whether it's morning, afternoon, or night, we're always happy to have you listening, have you watching, whether it be on iTunes or YouTube, whatever it may be. How you doing, Dima?
I'm doing great, man. Welcome back.
Thank you. Yeah, it's good to be back.
Welcome back, Mike. Welcome back. It's nice to have you. I know a lot of the followers were missing you for a little while. Even if they think your name is Mark, but how was the trip, man? Tell us, because we were talking about it and we were talking about, you know, being on Snapchat and watching you travel across Europe. How was the trip from your words?
It was great. Very relaxing. A lot of good food. Italy was probably my favorite. So we did London for a bit. We were outside of London for a wedding. And then Italy for a good bit as well. The pasta.
Yeah.
Oof. The pasta, man. I have a good metaphor as well for the dapp update whenever we get there with you, Q. I'm gonna put you on the hot seat, like you said last podcast. But yeah, it was good. I'm happy to be back in the great US of A. But a fun trip. Thanks for holding it down while I was gone.
Yeah, we'll have some videos. You sent us some videos to put in the last podcast. So we're gonna add them into this podcast and show you, traversing and drinking beer as you like to do. But what was your favorite city?
Probably Sorrento. Yeah, Sorrento. It's like right on the Mediterranean. I should have taken more videos. I think I did some in like the first few days and then they kind of tailed off. But I was trying to leave the phone in the room, you know, trying to disconnect a little bit. But crystal clear water, that whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, great food. Everything's local. Brought some cheese back, brought some pasta back. So, yeah, we eating well, even though IOST's under a penny, at least for those 4 days in Sorrento, yeah. We eating well.
Yeah, we're always eating well at the Finch's house. So, so we have comments from last week. I want to get to it right away because last week we made it a point to talk about it in the beginning of the episode. You guys came back in full force with the previous episode talking about the comments that you guys left. We had a 1,000 IOST giveaway to the best comment that we'll get to at the end of the episode. So again, appreciate you guys getting to the comments section and doing what you guys do there. There's going to be a lot of topics that we can discuss as well, and that will be at the end of the episode. Other than that, we have a six to seven day countdown here for the release of the new podcast, as well as that news that we've been shilling you guys for about the last month. On the IOST related announcement that we do have with a couple other nodes. So there is like an Easter egg out there. I think ICAC, had put something out as far as we were on the ICAC call and they kind of had a transcript of it. So it was a Easter egg, probably two sentences in there that kind of gives away what it is, but I'm not going to link it. You guys can go find it. But other than that, what's up? What's going on? You guys got any more topics?
I would say, should we do like a little mini giveaway if somebody can figure it out and comment before we announce? So the announcement will be on, it'll most likely be Tuesday night Eastern, or if you're over Asian time, it'll probably be Wednesday morning. So if you can comment on this podcast, figuring out what it is before that, like you said, you got to hunt it down. What do you think? Maybe 10,000 IOST? Seem fair?
Let's go.
Let's do it, man. Yeah.
Let's do it. What's the name right now?
Coming back.
There goes Dimitri on his fake account.
Coming back in a giving mood.
Boom. I'm ready, man. Let's do it. But yeah, we got some fun things coming for sure. I mean, whether it's IOST or otherwise here with Sutler, we got some things still rolling. I know it's been a lot of hype or announcements, but we're working behind the scenes here for you guys for sure.
As long as we come through with the goods in the end, everyone will be fine. That's the real problem. People hate shillers that don't come through. We're coming through for you guys.
Yeah, sometimes Santa's a little late. Maybe the 26th, 27th. It is what it is. He's a busy guy.
As long as he delivers.
What?
As long as he delivers.
As long as he delivers.
I wasn't in a household that had Santa be late. Were you that kid?
I wasn't. No, I was the kid that tried to like videotape Santa and prove that he wasn't real.
Nice. All right. Well, the semantics, we'll move on here. We've got a packed episode per usual, kind of a light week, but we still have a ton of topics. ViaBTC and IOST partnership, that's a staking pool that Deem is going to get into. ICAC did an interview with Korean node IOST World, which was semi-interesting. METX did a buyback. Our biweekly report, which comes out every 2 weeks, obviously, is out. We have another Demon's Desk. We got another staking pool, some dapp statistic updates, and a Binance gaming hackathon. And again, like we said, we'll talk about comments at the end of the episode, as well as the winner of the previous comment left in the chat. Mike had to come in and usurp my 1,000 IOST. It's still meaningful.
For sure. Absolutely. Deem, what's going on with ViaBTC?
Yeah, so IOST is getting listed on exchange on CoinEx, and ViaBTC is another pool, essentially. It's just similar to the pools that we've been having in this ecosystem, which is great. For the CoinEx, I mean, if you remember CoinEx from back in the day, there used to be the powerhouse. They're still, you know, the powerhouse, not as much as anymore as the other exchanges. They dropped a little bit, but they still have, you know, from 7,000 to 10,000 active users daily. And if you look at their trading volume, you know, 24-hour trading volume is 657 million. So they're still a solid exchange. You know, it's good to have IOST listed there. And of course, as always, they have, you know, some type of promotion for newly listed token like IOST, where they're gonna have an airdrop. It's a pretty, actually, you know, somewhat complex in terms of how they're gonna do it, because they do it for the token holders of the exchange, as well as some IOST holders. And so the airdrop is gonna occur. They have the times and everything outlined there. Basically, just to stimulate the community that exchange has to introduce IOST, and that broadens the overall, you know, knowledge about IOST, you know, and so on. So when the token gets listed on exchange, it's an opportunity for them to gain more, you know, community from that exchange. So that's great news. Like I said, there's going to be that, you know, 300,000 IOST airdrop. That's going to happen. So if you want to participate in that, you can probably find more information in the description that we'll put in.
Yeah, I'll drop the airdrop rules that they have. They kind of made an announcement. All of these exchanges are finding some ways to incentivize holding their own token, and that's off the Binance model. I don't know if another exchange might have done it before, and Binance did it correctly and had the most popularity and gains the most notoriety from it. Hence me saying that it's the Binance model, but a ton of exchanges are doing this token model, and yeah, so you hold CET as their token, and then do you have to hold IOST as well, Dima, or
no. The requirements say that you have to hold CET, and then obviously you have to hold it in a specific time frame where it's 5 days before it gets, you know, listed, and then and then after that, basically, depending on how much CT you have different tiers of.
I see. Okay. Yeah, I see it here. So if you hold more than 500,000 CET, then you get a subscription quota of 5, which is the max you can have. And then each subscription is, it looks like 600 per share.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Interesting. Awesome. Gotcha. And CoinEx is, I think I, you know, CoinEx, what, they're like 32nd in volume or something, 34th. Yeah. So they're not huge, but a lot of people seem to pay attention because they have backing from Bitmain. Mm-hmm. I think is that right? Yeah. Where, you know, Bitmain is, you know, for those who don't know, one of the largest, if not the largest Bitcoin miner out.
Yeah.
So when you've got somebody like that behind you, people tend to pay attention. So it's good to, you know, even if behind the scenes, it's good to get IOST kind of in the same conversations of somebody like a Bitmain or a CoinEx.
Yeah, no, it's definitely good news.
Yeah, definitely. And it's worth it to point out that IOST ABC is involved as well. I don't know to what, I don't know if the same let's see here. It says ViaBTC. It says IOST, which built the IOST ABC Block Explorer and a significant contributor to the IOST mainnet, also plays an important role in the ViaBTC ecosystem. So I don't know. It doesn't go into detail there, but IOST ABC is involved with ViaBTC as well. So that's good.
Yeah, I wonder if IOST ABC is ViaBTC or if they just had ViaBTC build the Block Explorer IOST ABC. But yeah, I mean, it's, you know, good to see multiple block producers working together there for sure. So yeah, take a look. 300,000 IOST airdropped. You know, seems to be a better opportunity kind of for your more standard traders or investors, where a lot of the trading competitions, like, you really don't have a chance, you know, unless you have like some crazy market making algorithm or something, because everybody's going to be able to move things back and forth algorithmically faster. So some good opportunity there to actually grab a chunk of IOST. The next thing we have here is the ICAC interview. So ICAC has started to do these interviews here. First one with IOST World. You know, there wasn't kind of a lot of meat to it. It was kind of focused on 100 and 100 venture capital, which we've talked about maybe 10 podcasts ago or so, whenever they kind of came to the forefront of the IOST ecosystem at first. But it's a good, concise interview. There's about 7 questions. You know, good job by ICAC putting this together. IOST World basically explaining that, you know, they're in Korea, that's their main focus. You know, they want to, you know, certainly bring IOST to as many Korean investors and users as possible. The biggest thing here for me is 100 to 100 Venture Capital, which has been around since 2017, has done very well. 30 to 40 well-known investments, including Syndicator, Zilliqa, Gifto, Icon, Contents Protocol, which we've talked about before offline, Airblock. So, you know, they've got some good investments there and have basically said that they have made a big investment into IOST in some way as well.
Yeah, I've got some PTSD from seeing Syndicator on there. For people that are at home, Mike got me into Syndicator when the Binance hype was going on, and hype was, you know, pretty much at a peak in
good old alt season.
Yeah, it was basically the height of alt season. Anything you bought had a chance to, you know, shoot up 30% overnight. And so we're looking at, you know, different investments that we can get into. And Mike goes, you know, Syndicator is one that I really, you know, am hot on. And I go to hit the market buy button because I'm a pleb. And right when I hit the market buy button, he goes, I don't really know what it does though. So that is classic. A classic alt season story for you guys.
Classic. Yeah, those were good times. Maybe we'll see those again here in the coming months or years or millennia. But yeah, that's good old Syndicator. I wonder how they're doing.
Not good. I never sold.
You never sold.
Wait, you still hold?
What's the latest?
Wow. No, we flipped a little bit on that. Oh. So it was a good trade after all, but would have liked some more research coming in from your end.
Yeah, I remember. Well, the problem was that the research didn't really lead to anything, I think was kind of the conclusion. So, you know, it was kind of, they had all these, you know, very, very fancy kind of algorithms that they were going to use for trading and then it's like once they published them, it was like, well, like, what is this though? You know. So,
and at that moment, you told me to buy.
At that moment, I was like,
"Yo, because Mike was selling."
I got 300,000 Syndicator. No. I would never do that. Speaking of buying, but I stole that one from you there.
Dang, oh yeah, got me good.
Zing, METX. What's going on with this buyback thing?
Is making moves.
So he had a buyback of 10 million METX. So it's great. He talks about,
it's a buyback and a burn, correct?
Yeah, buyback and a burn. It's like a combo.
So 150,000 IOST. The current METX value is approximately 0.01345 IOST. We did some math and altogether that came out to
like $1,000, I think.
Yeah.
So basically what he's saying in the blog post is that, unless we completely miss this, was that there are 65 million METX tokens. They bought back 10 million, which equates to over 150,000 IOST worth of the buyback, which, you know, based on the METX price is like $1,000.
Yeah.
So anyway, cool buyback to see from those guys happening.
Yeah. What's the importance of the of doing that buyback and doing that burn, Dima?
That's a good question.
Well, I mean, the, you know, anytime you're doing a buyback and a burn, you're taking tokens out of the circulating supply.
So then the supply and demand.
Right, exactly. So similar to like the staking economy, right? Where as you guys talked about on the last podcast, the more folks that we have come on board and either buy IOST OTC or off the, you know, the public markets and then stake it, the more IOST you have being pulled out of the circulating supply. Yeah. So same deal here. It's just the actual team, the actual METX team doing this, which brings up an interesting point too, it about how IOST has kind of been planning or has done this a little bit. I mean, you can kind of see where IOST may have potentially bought back some tokens at certain price levels that, you know, maybe the goal was to hold them or whatnot. We haven't seen that much,
right?
You know, I think whether it's IOST or METX or these other projects, I mean, people seem to be kind of waiting for some relief in alts,
yeah,
you know, before
they do big commitment. So, I mean, we see a lot of pools that are being set up, you know, that are contributing to, you know, taking that out of the circulating supply, like you said. So we only have all these pools set up, you know, and you have more tokens getting locked up. So, you know,
right there. Yeah. And you're basically messing with supply and demand. I mean, Binance does this expertly with their BNB token. And in a lot of ways they can't do wrong because at the end of the day, they have so many users that, you know, even if they implement something and it's not a big hit relative to how many users they have, it is a big hit. So, you know, in their IEO setup, I'm not sure if it's still the same. I know they've been messing with it, but back in the day, you know, you would have to hold a certain amount of BNB for a certain amount of days before the IEO in order to get access to the IEO. So if you have millions of users who are now like, oh shit, I want to get that, you know, Matic network or seller token or whatever it is, I need BNB. So what am I going to do?
Right.
I'm going to go out and buy BNB. So if everybody's doing that at the same time, you have a ton of new buying pressure, not necessarily any new selling pressure unless there's, you know, some other issue. So, you know, and those caps can vary, you know, maybe the caps are higher or lower based on the project, and kind of what the project wants, but there are a ton of different ways to kind of go about messing with that. You know, yeah. I would guess METX is kind of trying to spur some activity. It's always good to see that commitment from those folks over there, you know, doing that buyback and doing that burn, spending that money for users.
Yeah, it's interesting because he didn't give a timeline, and not to say that he should by any means with the timeline that he was buying these tokens back. But looking at IOST DEX and looking at the volume, it's not like there was a single spurt. There were a couple 1 and 2 million METX token days here or there. But I think he, you know, over the long period of time was buying back 100K, 200K here for a number of days. But it'd be interesting to see when that started. So. Yeah, that's a great story. So we'll move on to the next one here. That biweekly report that we always like to get to. What's Korea Cacao doing now?
Oh man, it is exactly the same actually. 3,000 users. So for those of you just tuning into our update of the biweekly update, we like to troll the community growth stats. All the other ones seem to fluctuate, except for Korea Cacao. Korea Cacao is always stuck at 3,000.
Nobody's in.
No one's out, man.
Nobody. Yeah, that is the tightest locked group in on this side of the planet, or I guess that side of the planet if we're talking Korea. But yeah, I haven't managed to find my way in and be that 0.001 of that group. But I'll let you guys know if I do get in and you do see an update there.
Yeah, please do. We'll ask that they you know make it a 4-digit. Tally there on the community growth. But anyway, shorter biweekly report than normal. Some big news here. collaboration with some blockchain security providers. I would imagine maybe kind of in response to the IOST play stuff. That's good to see from IOST. I'm just hitting bullet points here. The LOL or emoji token airdrop, the Genesis airdrop has finished. If you didn't get any, it doesn't mean that you can't participate. There will be multiple airdrops still coming. Yeah. But you do need to, as far as I know, have IOST and vote with it. Right. Mm-hmm. So make sure you're doing that. That's, great incentive for new users to get in, buy IOST and vote. Looks like some updates on mainnet, some nice technical support for dapp teams is coming. And then speaking of emoji as well, they're starting testing on some more long-term airdrop distribution. Specific to articles, the biggest thing here for me, kind of looking at the biweekly report under a broader context, was that IOST is continuing to expand into other countries in Asia, specifically Singapore, Vietnam. Those two have been major focuses. They basically have struck a handful of different partnerships and run through some AMAs and various organic marketing in Vietnam. And then Singapore, where, Singapore is obviously a very wealthy country and, technically it's very innovative. So the strategy in Singapore seems to be a bit different. They're looking to really partner more with, say, your government R&D types, your organizations who are focused on new blockchain technology or research or just kind of general open innovation, right? So in this case, it was IMDA, which is the Infocom Media Development Authority in Singapore. So Vietnam has been a focus. Singapore has been a focus. Like I said, we've got some updates with emoji. There's a new MMORPG game coming. But other than that, that was really, pretty much what we heard from the biweekly report. We talked to IOST this morning. Interesting thought from them is they're really looking at Japan next. Yeah. So Japan.
We talked about it quite a bit on previous podcasts, how we saw, that focus in Japan and how hard it was to penetrate Japan. Remember, you're talking about from a regulatory standpoint. So seeing that growth, and success is definitely, good.
Yeah. Yeah. They're kind of checking the boxes, I guess. Right. If you turn back the clock, and this is some context that I don't know if we've ever kind of touched on, but whenever we joined with IOST, and really started getting involved kind of the depths of the bear market, they had plans for offices on the West Coast of the US. They had plans for, I think, an office in Germany, and had to kind of dial back for a bit as the bear market continued to worsen. So rather kind of blowing all the funds, kind of take a step back, reevaluate, make sure that you're in it for the long haul. So as that happened, I think there was a real shift in focus to maybe some easier wins than, say, US as a whole or Europe as a whole. Looking at Vietnam, looking at Japan, looking at Korea, where, assuming you can handle the regulatory burdens, like we've seen them attack with that legal firm in Japan, or making some strategic partnerships in Singapore with government bodies. If you can handle that, you can really kind of go out and be one of the few that has a focus in a country that is smaller geographically, but large when it comes to users within crypto.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you're looking at like US, for example, the regulations here are definitely not easy, and especially like the guidelines and the structure is not as clear as other countries that are trying to promote this innovation, like something like Singapore, so those quick wins, definitely can help out. While in long run, we're still working on having US, as the expansion of that market.
Yeah. So, I had a question to go along with this, but before I'll just come out and say it, it seems like the US user is almost last in line here because the dapp developer or the protocol developer or the protocol team doesn't want to have to deal with all the regulation and all this BS that's going on. And that's unfortunate because there's a ton of users on this side of the wall. It's like so close yet so far away. And it's super unfortunate to see that the US is putting themselves behind with this regulation stuff, but it makes sense why IOST would be going to these crypto-friendly nations, these blockchain-friendly nations, and Japan seems to be doing it really well, as we've said before. I guess my question would be these to the normal user when they're gaining partnerships with these government entities or the entities attached to these governments like Singapore, where do you see that actually leading to? Because it makes for a great headline, but something tangible that can benefit IOST more than just the optics of, hey, we inked this partnership. Where do you see that leading down the road?
Yeah, I mean, I think they're all small wins for just general growth with the ecosystem, right? In the same way that one staking pool coming on board isn't going to radically affect the supply and demand of IOST and kind of, you know, that balance, but having dozens of various staking pools coming on board where, you know, each one, whether it's an exchange or otherwise, has users and has a community that it can kind of showcase IOST to, these partnerships are the same way, right? I imagine every single partnership is not going to lead to some giant growth, but, you know, if we can get regular everyday users in Singapore interested or in Japan interested, even if it's not some sort of massive business to business, you know, cooperation between IOST and fill in the blank, at least it's kind of, it's general growth for the ecosystem. It's IOST out there kind of spreading the word. So that's my thought there. We do need to go into Dimitri's desk. We'll take a quick break here. Tell us when Bitcoin's going to pump, man. Tell us when we're going to get some relief.
Let's go. It's the highlights.
Highlights. Check it out.
Welcome back, guys, to another episode of Dimitri's Desk, where we cover technical analysis in crypto markets. This is episode 11, and man, we have a packed episode for today. Volatility is back. Volumes are up. Things are moving. We're going to recap our indicators from last week and take a look at the most important charts, BTC, IOST, ETH, EOS. And we're going to take a look at the COT report, fear indicator, and we're going to talk a lot about the volume. Who is getting wrecked and who is making money in this market right now? And lots of you may be asking, when is this correction going to be over? When are we going to bounce back up? We're going to discuss all of that and more on this episode.
All right, welcome back from Dimitri's Desk Highlights. Look for the full episode in our channel. And so moving forward with our topics here, another announcement with HyperPay partnership. So these guys are legit. If you don't know about them, they have tons of users. They have 500,000 members right now in their program. Basically, what they do is it's a multi-chain wallet that offers a lot of different services. Like you can do, they just introduced peer-to-peer lending right now. They give out interest if you lock up certain amount of tokens on an annual basis. But yeah, looking at their platform, having an IOST, you know, having the ability to hold IOST with them and then also stake and get that interest through HyperPay is a great thing, obviously, because they have tons of users that are already using this platform to gain interest from various other, you know, staking or interest tools. And now we're going to have IOST. So again, we're going into that, you know, taking it out of circulation and staking it and earning interest through these platforms that have tons of users and built out community, and they're well known in this industry. So, I mean, you know, just looking through it, they have an exchange. You can exchange, you know, obviously trade. You can do off-chain transactions between wallets. What's interesting also, right on their homepage, at the top, they have Libra on-chain wallet. So that's a little interesting. Yeah. So I'm not sure what that's all about. But
looks like they have a lot of giveaways and stuff too. Yeah. So if you're somebody who's looking for that, if you're a big giveaway person, check out the website. It's just, what is it? Just Hyper?
Hyperpay.tech.
Hyperpay.tech. So yeah, another staking pool.
Yeah. It'll be interesting to see how IOST grades all these staking pools against each other, because they're obviously in the same category. So once it comes to quarter three and quarter four contribution rewards, it'll be interesting to see. I don't know why I always go back to this. I think I like the idea of, you know, the competition between at least nodes in the same category. I think it spurs a little bit of growth. I think humans are naturally competitive, or maybe I just am, but it'll be interesting to see how IOST kind of, you know, says, oh, how do we put this staking pool against, you know, this staking pool? Is it the amount staked? Is it the amount of giveaways they're doing? What actually separates a staking pool from each other?
Yeah, and we're not, you know, I don't want to kind of beat them to the punch here and give it away, but in talking to IOST this morning, one thing that they briefly mentioned on the call was an interesting announcement towards more decentralization that will be coming either next week or in the coming week. So stay tuned to the blog there, kind of hyping that up a little bit here on this podcast. But I know it's something they've been thinking about and working on for some time that will have to do with these contribution rewards. So stay tuned, there. But yeah, I mean, you're right. Like there are hundreds of various nodes now. So until we see end of Q3, you know, these nodes will, including us, will basically just keep working, you know, trying to get that top spot.
So having like a pool bi-weekly report, you know, or something like that. Hey. You know, I was talking about in the last podcast that with the emoji airdrop, you know, they did mention if you didn't receive the airdrop, it's a possibility that, you know, you have to contact your the pool that you voted for, that you're participating in, to see what's going on there. And, you know, basically they'll provide more information on that. If you've received the right amount, or you think you didn't receive the right amount, they'll be able to, you know, essentially clarify it for you. So I haven't seen much information from the community in terms of feedback of these pools just yet, but it would be definitely interesting to see that going forward, see how they compare to each other. And because I think there's definitely that factor of competition, like you mentioned, because when we had that ICAC call, they did say that in China or in Asia, they're actually, you know, pretty competitive when it comes to setting up, you know, nodes and rewards and so on. So it'll be interesting to see how they all kind of pair up against each other.
Yeah.
Speaking of China, I was on that call this morning too, Mike, with IOST. I don't know if you heard me on there. Did you hear me on there?
Yeah, I heard you on there. Okay, you were there.
Right, you were breathing there.
am I breathing? Sorry. But anyways, there was another kind of Chinese focused thing that they were getting at. Is that something we can tell the community, or is that something that's kind of under wraps for now? What do we think?
Yeah, I mean, we'll keep it transparent. So one of the big things we've been working on has been a ledger integration. You know, it seems like in kind of the, what I'll call, crypto political landscape of things, that ledger is going to be put on hold in favor of a Chinese based cold wallet, basically. So I don't want to give away the reason why they're you know, making this change, or at least this kind of, you know, change in priority, where up until really this morning, ledger was the priority, yeah, right? Until they basically told us that they need to put that on hold for a different one. All in all, it's a good thing. You know, it sucks to not have ledger under the timeline that we were expecting. You know, we were expecting that to really happen in September, October at the latest. So that's going to be on hold. We're going to keep pushing IOST for that. But you know, it's not like it's kind of a no-win situation, I guess. Yeah. Right. The you know, while we want to have ledger, the the other things coming are definitely good for IOST, but I don't want to give that away now because I don't know what's happening behind the scenes with who IOST is working with on that front. But you know, I guess some bad news now, you know, some time still until Ledger, but some good news to come from IOST. Hopefully here in the coming weeks, we'll hear what that kind of, you know, new announcement of sorts is.
Yeah. And it's interesting to see actually how popular Ledger is in Asia in those areas compared to like other, you know, wallets that exist there that came out there. So, you know, obviously we know that Ledger dominates the US and Europe markets, you know, so the expansion for IOST, it could be huge in those markets with the Ledger integration. But, you know, it'd be interesting to see what the impact is also on Asia with the Ledger integration, you know, so that's something to just think about. But yeah, we, you know, we're even though we're on hold, we still have all the resources in place to move forward once we're ready. We actually have Jason from Block Arcade is helping out as well. So shout out to him. Yeah.
Yeah. So
claps for Jason.
Yeah. Claps for Jason for sure. We'll keep everybody posted on this. Like we said, we should hear that good news from IOST and in the coming weeks or month, you know. So stay tuned there. Until then, Q, what is going on in the world of dApps?
Yeah, so the world of dApps, I mean, obviously we have the dApp rankings that come out on dapp.com, so I'm not going to take up too much time with these dApp updates, but you know, IOST is kind of positioning itself as a scalable kind of user-facing dApp protocol, obviously. So it makes sense to kind of look at the statistics and give you an idea of where the dApps are, you know, essentially at and what they've done over the past 30 days. And I'll probably do this once every month, or if you know, we find value to it once every podcast, we'll figure it out. But you know, right now, basically IOST Play, IOST Win, Block Arcade, Vegas, and Game are really taking the majority of the volume. I think over that time though, on 30-day volume, IOST Win has done a good amount. I think they're up somewhere like in the vicinity of 84% on a 30-day timeline. Block Arcade, because it started a month ago, obviously has some good growth. They're up 200% on their volume. These obviously, the gambling platforms make a lot of sense when you're talking about volume. Those are, that's really the lifeblood of these gambling platforms. Play has gone down over that time, 30% over the 30-day period. Liebe Pool has some interesting stuff go on because with the annualized returns, those shift very frequently. I don't know if they're how they're manipulated and things like that. So you'll see, like for example, over a 7-day period, Liebe Pool is up 2,000% on its volume. Now that has a lot to do with the APR switching from 15% to 25%, and what goes beyond that. And I don't pretend to know exactly what goes into supply and demand there, and what changes that percentage, at least somewhat. But Liebe Pool's up over 7 days, but down on the 30-day. But pretty much we've got IOST Win and Block Arcade, you know, up in volume over that time. Other than that, you see a lot of, you know, 30%, 40% dips in volume, which is concerning to one point. I know IOST Play had that situation go on with the quote-unquote, what would you even call him now? Not a hacker, but like an exploiter. and all the fallout from that, and you know, him having those tokens and dumping those tokens. So there's a lot of stuff's going on. It's good to see, you know, some platforms getting an up in volume. As far as users go, I don't know if you guys are you guys looking at these rankings at dapp.com too?
Yep.
Yeah, so DEX is doing well over a 30-day period. They're up 30%. Let's see what else we got
here. IOST Voter is up 100%, man.
Yeah, that just needs to go away, to be honest. But yeah, I'm not going to keep you guys too long. Obviously, we do those dapp.com rankings, and this is not that. But it's important to talk about the volume and the users, because as a, you know, dApp user-facing dApp protocol, without the users and the volume, it doesn't. What are we doing? You know, that's basically at least the way I look at it.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I think the IOST Play issue was a big hit. I mean, you can see the data on volume is, you know, 30 day transaction volumes, it's down like 63%. So that was a big, hit, I think, for IOST play and kind of IOST dApps in general. But understanding that I think is one small piece to the plan here.
If you look at that,
is important.
Endless games down about 60%.
Yeah,
as well. So
yeah.
Endless is coming to an end.
Yeah, that was a good. I like that. That little shtick in the last podcast.
But yeah, he listened to the last podcast, Dima. You can't make that joke twice.
Old damn thing. Sorry, didn't laugh this time.
You know that 8BTC interview with Ray. It was interesting to hear that Ray, or it might have been Terry, I don't know which one said it, but that emoji wasn't going to be on any dApp Explorers.
Yeah, and it would really just kind of blow it away. I mean,
you want that?
I would love that. Yeah, I mean, I feel like, you know, based on the users that they're quoting and the activity that they're quoting on a daily basis, I mean, it would be first from the jump. But again, I think the problem becomes how much they want to kind of give away to these dApp Explorers as well. Right. Or I imagine in kind of the, it's kind of what?
Like the stats and like,
yeah.
Oh yeah.
Like at the end of the day, data is king right now. So if I am if I'm Ray, right. And I kind of got this feel from the interview too, and that he knows what he has with emoji, right. He knows that what they have is incredibly valuable, not just to the crypto sphere, but to, you know, just in general as an application, as a whole. So, you know, point number one, obviously great news for IOST, great news for the whole emoji team, all of that, right? They're going to be bringing in some nice cash through this app. You know, it's going to do great things for the emoji token, I'm sure, as they continue to build it out to users. But when you kind of understand what these dApp Explorers can do or will do in the near future, you know, it would basically kind of expose all of the data that emoji has that they may or may not want to allow users to sell, or sell to other businesses, or sell to advertisers or whatnot. Right. So, you know, this isn't me talking on any sort of like privacy policy or data regulations or anything like that. It's just, you know, thinking about it as a business, the pros and cons to being number one on dapp.com or Dapp Radar or whatever it is, versus giving away what could be a giant revenue opportunity, you know, especially when your competition is like Snapchat and TikTok.
Right. Yeah.
That's like, you know, one misstep and you might be back out of the top 10, or they might, you know, kind of quash you in those areas. So it sucks that we won't get that, but I think it's probably the better long-term move for Ray and for them. And at the end of the day, I mean, the thing that matters most is that emoji is bringing users to IOST. And kind of looking forward, what I'm most excited about is how OnBlock integrates with all of this, right? Because OnBlock seems to be the bridge between, say, users of emoji who don't know anything about crypto or very little, and games like Block Arcade or IOST Play or IOST Staking in general. You know, how can OnBlock continue to grow alongside emoji, alongside IOST, to kind of bridge that gap so that somebody who is using emoji, you know, now has easy access to OnBlock and thus easy access to the IOST ecosystem?
Yeah, we've covered it a little bit on the last podcast, like the update on the OnBlock situation. You know, you remind me of something from Berminal's side when we were talking about the predictions that you do on like the BTC, right? So, you know, we were talking about, hey, you know, Ray is probably, or their team is probably tracking you because you've been killing it in those predictions and they're selling that to hedge funds.
right, yeah.
So, data is definitely huge, you know, so I totally agree with everything you said there.
Yeah, I mean, and you were talking about bringing new users into IOST. And I think a lot of times, at least from the answer that I just gave, it even shows that we're often focused within the crypto community, whereas it, like not having it on dapp.com and not having it on dapp radar, it makes sense because everything they've said is about bringing new users, not to IOST, but to crypto in general. I mean, that is the funnel, right? Like it's obviously going to happen that they want to bring users to IOST. That makes perfect sense. But in general, they want new users, not just users from, you know, other protocols or just Bitcoin maximalists or ETH maximalists. They want to bring new users into crypto, which makes sense. Like those users aren't using dapp.com. They could care less about, you know, the statistics that they're showing to us, which kind of sucks, but they want the statistics shown on Google Play and
right
Google Store and iOS Apple Store and things like that. Those are the bigger fish to fry. So it makes sense.
Yeah, I agree. So we'll keep everybody up to date on that scenario. You know, obviously Emoji is you know, seemingly still really growing it at quite a clip. So as whether it's airdrop or otherwise, we'll obviously keep you guys updated on that front. The dapp thought I had in I guess it was today,
here we go.
Super cheesy. And maybe should be reserved for when we have the dapp rankings. But in Italy, like all the food is local, right? You don't get any of the preservatives or processed shit. So if you're looking at these dapps here, Q, putting you on the hot seat, which ones are the delicious local Italian food and which ones are the like terrible processed
GMO
chicken Caesar salad I had in the airport?
Yeah. I mean, what you're talking about is love, right? Yeah. What has love inside of it? What has the soul inside of it? And
there we go.
What is cheap and what is kind of just, you know,
it still tastes good. You know, I mean, it could be cheap, you know, and have all those bad things in it, but still tastes good. You know,
that's true. Fair point.
Like Popeye's chicken before the change.
Oh, no. Now we're really delving into a different. Right. Yeah.
Okay. Anyways, I like, you know, right now I like IOST. It mirrors my dapp rankings. I like what IOST Play is doing. I think they have the right intentions as far as, you know, building up their whole ecosystem as opposed to just, hey, let me put a gambling platform out there and see what happens.
Fake users.
I think IOST Win is involved. I say this a lot, but not enough. That IOST Win actually is a team behind IOST Dex. So I like those two combined as helping the ecosystem. Endless is a great example of something that at the end of the day, it kind of feels plastic. Block Arcade, these things that you can, you know, that the team has good intentions. That might be a Western belief and maybe not such a, you know, Eastern kind of culture belief where they're just trying to get out games and see what sticks. But yeah, to answer your question, I like Play, I like Win, Dex, and Block Arcade.
Nice.
Those are the ones with the soul in them.
Beautiful, man. I like it. I like how my man always integrating the love. We're going to read the new name is the Love Podcast with that love guy.
Yep. That's love guy. What was the name you were trying to get me to switch to on Twitter?
Shitcoin Shepherd.
Keeps coming back.
If you guys, if anybody out there thinks Shepherd is amazing and Q should switch, please comment on the podcast and YouTube, Twitter. Hit him up directly at Shitcoin Shepherd on Twitter. No, I'm just kidding.
You won't find any Shitcoin Shepherd tag, and unless we get like 10,000 retweets, I'm not changing my name to Shitcoin Shepherd, so that's never gonna happen. But anyways, let's move on. We got the rest of the episode here. Binance Labs, actually, this is pretty cool. They announced a gaming hackathon. Now these aren't global. I'm sure they'll be pulling in from teams around the world, but these are actually going to be, I believe, three separate rounds where they're going to have hackathons at a location. I don't know exactly where, but essentially they're doing this game hackathon, and the developers are building on HTML5 and reaction type. And then they're going to be competing against each other and Binance, at a chance for Binance to, one, give them a reward, as well as maybe make some Binance Labs investment. So this is really cool, man. Like Binance has always done a great job. I think they do a great job. That's a good example of a nice Italian food. But they got good intentions, and they're in an industry that they're making moves in an industry that I'm super interested in, which is blockchain gaming. I think not enough is being done there right now, and then there's an untapped potential. So if you can get a company like Binance and Binance Labs and put together a global-ish gaming hackathon for them to create games and then get investment from Binance, that seems awesome to me.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, the three of us are gamers, for anybody that doesn't know that. So anything kind of gaming related, and really anything that involves gaming and blockchain, like, you're checking all the boxes for us. Yeah. Really, you know. The other big thing too I like is that with Binance, it seems that they're not just kind of talking the talk, but they're walking the walk as well when it comes to what people would call building or biddling, and the kind of the whole new shtick that was this hopefully previous bear market, and not, you know, hopefully we're out of that by now, but they continue to initiate development, whether it's gaming focused or otherwise. And I mean, we kind of hit on this earlier in the podcast, but like, Binance can seemingly do no wrong. I mean, does anybody even remember that they got hacked or
what?
You know, right. any of this? About? Yeah, exactly. It's like
CZ tried to roll back the Bitcoin chain. Yeah. Like, dude,
oh, yeah. CZ almost single-handedly ruined the entire crypto space. No, it was fine. Yeah.
What a speaker.
He had his like finger right up next to the launch nuclear buttons. He had all the keys in place, and then he was just like, "Nah." Or at least we all decided no.
Psych.
An entire millennial generation's savings just wiped out instantly by CC.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Yeah,
exactly.
He's going to do a token burn, you know?
Yeah. Well, that was the... that was like the massive conspiracy theory that we were all fucking around with back, which was like, oh, so this was CC's plan all along.
Yeah.
He gets hacked, rolls back Bitcoin, destroys Bitcoin, and then pumps BNB. Yep. BNB is the new BTC.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, right.
That's like Zuckerberg-esque. Man. But anyways, as far as the Binance gaming hackathon goes, there are going to be 48-hour on-site hackathons. They don't say how many they're going to have, although I guess you could put it together. But the first one's going to be in Shanghai, September 20th to the 22nd. The top three teams are going to win 30,000, 20,000, and 10,000 Chinese yuan. And then the other hackathons are going to be in the U.S., in South Korea, and India. So I guess you can say there that they're planning on having four of these global hackathons each time, you know, delivering out whatever denomination currency at a certain price. And then, again, these are going to be non-solidity-based, non-blockchain code-based games. And I think that's a good way to approach it. Make a really cool game. And then that brings in outside developers too. It's not like, hey, you need to know Solidity to come to this hackathon. It's like, hey, you build regular, you know, traditional apps, then come in and build a cool game and see if you can get funding from this blockchain organization. But that's the details behind it. You guys think this is a good idea?
Yeah, I like it all in all. If you guys like it, if you hate it out there, hit us up in the comments. Let us know why. We got a few minutes left here. Q, let's hit some comments.
Ooh. Oh, wow. How much time we got?
We got about three, four minutes here.
Build up
some hype on the 1,000 IOST winner.
Yep. Okay. All right. That sounds good. So the 1,000 IOST winner we had decided was going to be Meta Crypto. And we'll read out his comment here. It says, great episode, guys. Even without Mark, Sutlerites are rocking. So he did a lot of cool things there, but let me get to the areas to focus. Exchanges for IOST and related tokens. We need robust DEX or centralized exchange with enough liquidity. How about bringing in Bancor to the IOST ecosystem? They have Ethereum, EOS, Tron. Liquidity issues solved. Nash is another platform. They focus on non-custodial, blah, 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 all non-custodial. And he goes on to say some other ones there. But so he touched on three points here. One, he called you guys Sutlerites, which as a group, we are all Sutlerites. And huge. I love that nickname. Two, he called Mike Mark, which is another great point to hit. And then three, he gave a great topic to speak on, although maybe we'll wait till next time since we don't have a lot of time. But yeah, liquidity and having other DEXs and other centralized exchanges for these dApp tokens would be great.
Yep, 100%. Good job, Meta Crypto. It's Mike, not Mark, though. Next time, not a winner.
Forward, you know, the podcast, it's going to be Mark.
definitely going to be Mark going forward. Guys, since we don't have a lot of time, I did you guys want to talk about any of these comments really quick? I think there were a lot of good ones to talk to. Maybe we just move it to next week's.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple we can hit on here. You know, I think a lot of people kind of agree with what we've been talking about, what IOST has been talking about, that, you know, it's small wins, right? Crypto philosopher says, great episode. I think IOST just needs to continue to build out the ecosystem. More games, more dApps, and from English-speaking perspectives, more translations.
Yeah, that's the one I really liked.
Yeah, that was a big one. That got 3 likes. If you'd have called me Mark, you probably would have won Crypto Philosopher. But shout out to that guy or gal there. I would agree. You know, I think it's small wins, whether it's expanding to Singapore, Vietnam, Japan, whether it's new games like Black Arcade or you know, IOST Play coming back here, or it's giant leaps like Emoji. You know, as long as we are trending in the right direction. As long as, you know, we see some nice relief in the general market overall, I think IOST will continue to be poised as, you know, a leading kind of undervalued project out there.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's a great point. And thank you to all the comments. We will get to a couple others on the next week's podcast. I know there was a couple talking about having the roadmap on the website. That would be great because it's really not up there. Talking about how staking is important as opposed to, you know, the increase in dApps. You're talking about why IOST is better than these other dApp protocols like EOS, like Tron. And I want to get in deep into all of these conversations, and I appreciate you guys leaving these comments. But we do have to go and run. This episode's coming to a close here. But one more time, explain that 10,000 IOST competition just for the people at home.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm trying to remember it here in 30 seconds. So if you can figure out what we're going to announce before we announce it and comment on this podcast in YouTube or on Twitter, you will win 10,000 IOST. The first person to do it, right? So we'll, you know, if we get it roughly the same time on Twitter and YouTube, we'll split it 5,000 and 5,000. But otherwise, the first one to hit that we see 10,000 IOST. But like we said, you got to go, you got to dig. So figure out what it is. Until next time.